do you feel this way?
Just relax, man. You gotta send yours too.
No, it's asking for you.
GoPro, stop recording. GoPro, stop recording.
So if you find it's not going into the gear you want, don't sort of force it, just drop the bike backwards and forwards. Just make it a little concerning just so you don't bend these gear sticks, okay? Because it does happen quite a lot and it makes it really hard to get into gear. Okay, so turn these on, they must be in neutral. And you've also got reverse in case you want to get stuck, you want to go backwards. So your screen will light up and then you just hold in that green button, okay? And hopefully your bike will start. Once it's started, take your thumb off and just wrap around. Off. Is just back the other way. So there's lots of quad bikes going. If you see me and Jamie like this, it means to turn your bikes off. Over here, this is your two-wheel drive. Your bike should be in two-wheel drive, but if you see us with our hand
five plus first,
we'll start their bikes first, and then if you guys just want to hang on, we'll just get them out of the way. So when you're ready, start them up.
Thank you.
track will give you a feel for what it's going to be like out there.
Just at the corner, it's nice and wide, nice and slow. You come up this wee thing, little turn at the end. Three times, and are you having a turn at driving?
No.
No? Okay, so then just park over there.
Yeah. Arthritis.
Yeah.
Appreciate it. Yesterday you couldn't even see that wee cannabis knob, that smallest wee hill just there, because it was raining so much. Can you everyone see the buildings over there? It's about 11 o'clock. Just against that hill there's some roofs. So that is the village, that's where we've come from. It's about 4 km away. So, we're talking about Franz Josef Glacier. It is one of three in the world that go from Alps to a temperate rainforest. If you drive 20 minutes that way, you've got another one, Fox Glacier. Slightly longer than this Franz Josef Glacier. It's about 12 kilometres long, and Franz is currently sitting about 10.5
kilometres
long.
What's the, do you know what the vertical drop is?
I don't. I know they're very, very steep for glaciers, but I don't know what the vertical drop is. So, at the moment, unfortunately, both of these glaciers are retreating quite rapidly just due to climate change. At the moment, they're both retreating 9 centimetres a day. So, my family's been in this town for 6 generations and they've seen that glacier a lot further back, so it moves all the time, but this time it's losing volume, so it's sinking down on itself and it's going back. And they've never seen it melt at such a fast rate, so they're a bit worried about it disappearing completely. We went to a glaciologist talk the other day and they said if the world heats up just 1 degree in the next 100 years, then we probably won't have a glacier anymore. So if you guys get the chance to walk up to the bottom of it or do a heli hike or a flight, definitely do, because you probably might be one of the last generations that get to see it. So if you guys can see the bottom of the glacier, so in 2008 that was in the riverbed, so you used to be able to walk just from the riverbed onto the glacier, but unfortunately, as I said, it's receded about 3 kilometers since then. So the only way to get there is by helicopter, which is why there's so many of them just going in and out all of the time. On a beautiful clear day there is 26 helicopters going in and out. So we have the busiest heliport in the southern hemisphere. You can see one's just coming into land now. They make mine and Jamie's voices a bit gone at the end of the day because they park right next to where we're at the beach. If you can see that greyish river just there, that's a Waiho River. It flows out the bottom of the glacier. It's about 1 degree all year round. Sometimes there's bits of ice that have fallen off the glacier floating past. It's pretty cool. If you fell in, you'd last 6 minutes before hypothermia kicked in. So it's a very, very cold river. If I just divert your attention to behind us, can you guys see this big sort of ridge? This is called the Waiho Loop, and it goes all the way around to the foothills over there. So you see it's like a semicircle. So this, if you can just imagine the glacier like a big bulldozer coming forward, 12,000 years ago it came forward and pushed up all this. So this is all terminal moraine. That's just trees and vegetation just growing on. So this is where the glacier used to be, and it's retreated way back up the valley there. So with that glacier moving so much, up the top where it's really steep, that part, if you picture it like a frozen river, that part's a waterfall and it can move 5 to 7 meters a day. It's a really, really fast moving for a glacier. So if you guys can see the buildings, goes to the right, there's a bus going across that bridge. Can everyone see it? There's a couple of cars going across the bridge. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So 90 years ago, you used to be able to fly a plane underneath that bridge. What we've been driving through used to be a massive gorge 90 years ago, so 60 meters deep. The town used to be called Waiho Gorge Village, but over the years with that glacier moving so much, you'll see on the side that sort of slipped in. So it's just eroding everything, all the thousands of tons of gravel's come out with the calories. So there's two valleys that join into one, and because of that lovely Waiho Loop, there's only a tiny gap for everything to flow out to sea. So usually all this gravel and stuff would just go out to sea, no problem, but unfortunately we've got a big natural stop bank. So this is just built up. At the moment it's sitting 10 metres higher than the town, so there's a little bit of a flooding risk. Luckily for us though, this river will never go bank to bank. It's a braided river like most of the ones on the west coast, so what it does is it, every time it floods it just picks a different path, which is why it's so wide. It's got so much place to, stuff to play in. Like in a couple of months if you come back, the river might be hard up against here. You'll see we lost those trees just not so long ago. Yeah, you can't really see it. Oh,
there are two big trees over there.
Yeah, there's two big trees that have fallen into the river over there. So the glacier was named by an explorer called... oh my goodness, my mind has gone blank. Julius von Hart. And did you guys been to Wanaka in Queenstown? Yeah. So you would have gone through Haast Pass. For those of you travelling, you'll go through it. So he came down to Franz Josef and he named the glacier after an Austrian emperor whose name was Franz Josef. And then the town later got its name after that. The Māori, this is the last thing I'm going to tell you, the Māori legend for the glacier and name for the glacier is slightly different. So they call the glacier Oroimata o Hine Hikitiri, which just translates to the tears of Hine Hikitiri. So she was an avalanche maiden. And she lived up there with her two parents. So if we just use our imaginations and pretend that there's no glacier. She lived up there with her two parents, and Māori legends, they have gods for everything. So they have a mountain god, sea god, land god, moon, everything. So up there, the mountain god is named Auraki. So if you guys heard that before, Auraki is the Māori name for Mount Cook. So he was their mountain god, and she was forbade for ever coming down to land. So she'd never met anyone other than her parents, and she was really keen to meet someone. After time, her parents passed away, so she snuck down these mountains behind Aorapi's back, came out into this river, walked out to the beach, and then 20 kilometres that way, there's a settlement called Okarito. And way back in time, that was a Māori tribe. And she was walking on the beach, and the first person she bumped into was a strapping young Māori man with big muscles, big punamu, you know, the green stone around his neck, little skirt made of kiwi feathers. He was pretty good looking. So those two locked eyes and instantly fell in love, and his name was Pawe, and he happened to be the chief of the tribe, so it was a pretty good catch. So she stayed with him for a while, and then after a time she felt the call to go back to the mountains. So one stormy night she snuck out from their hut and made her way back up this valley here. So she was nearly at the top of the hills, and she turned around, she saw Tawe scrambling up the hills after her. So just like she was forbade to ever come into land, Tawe was definitely not allowed up in those mountains. So Auraki woke up and he saw this, and he was very, very angry at Ohene Hikitiri for leaving and then for bringing a land person up into the mountains. So what he did was he created an earthquake, and unfortunately Tawe slipped and fell to his death. And this is where our people with hay fever start crying on cue. Yeah. Very sad. So Oroimata sat down and she cried and she cried, she cried for months. And eventually her tears filled up the entire glacier. And then Auraki was feeling a bit guilty at the stage, so as a tribute to her and her lost love, she froze her tears to form the glacier. So if you get the chance to go up there, if you lick the ice, it might taste a little bit salty, but I won't have to cut you. But yes, that's how the Māori legend goes. You can choose to believe it or not. But that's it. So we're going to go back a different way, guys. We'll make our way back through the riverbed, and then probably duck back through that way.
Look at my eye. Oh, allergies.
GoPro, stop recording. GoPro, stop recording. In 1750, the glacier was here, right on this spot. Thank you. the glacier was here on this spot. Look at the sign. I wish I could tape all the signs. So it kept moving back. Ryan, can you spot that? GoPro, stop recording.
Thank you. Here it's so cloudy today.
To drink it. No. 85 degrees.
No way.
Stop recording.